Chapter 2. My name is Tarn. Copra Island, Chonburi, 2019. As soon as both feet stepped on the seashore, Tarn was instantly aware that his life would forever change from this very second on. This island was the base of the Naval Special Warfare Unit, the training ground for the frogmen or Naval Special Warfare Operators, known as the SEALs, in a more elegant term, to sharpen their skills. SEAL was an acronym for sea, air, and land, representing the missions that would be carried out in all those environments. If he aced this 8-month intense training here, he would become eligible to join the DSI team, and he was here to win.
Hey, Tarn, let's get some grub. We have 2 hours before we report for duty.
Yai draped his arm across Tarn's shoulder and led his little brother to walk up on the cement floor, looking for a small restaurant at the same time. After searching for a moment, they stumbled upon a small restaurant by the sea. They seated themselves and ordered their food together. Since the restaurant wasn't very busy, the food was served just after a short while.
Hoo-yah! Hoo-yah! Hoo-yah!
Tarn swiveled his head with keen interest to those cadets in white t-shirts and navy blue shorts jogging in unison alongside their trainer. Their first 3 months of training would not be too far off from this. Even though those two brothers were here to join the DSI unit, the police colonel told them this training was similar to the Navy SEAL training program.
Hey, Tarn, check out that dude over there. It's like he dresses up for a fashion show.
Yai told Tarn to look that way. Tarn averted his gaze from the beach to a person sitting behind. That guy was wearing a black leather jacket, a rich kid, Tarn supposed. But Tarn was familiar with that back, like he had seen it somewhere before. Well, never mind. Tarn shifted his attention back to the plate before him.
Yai! Let's eat so we can get going. Stop gossiping already.
Tarn shoved the food into his mouth and munched on it. To fuel up a starvation tank like this, eating was the only answer.
That's what everyone does, don't they? Not only both of us in this training, but there are also many other good men out there. We have to keep our eyes on them.
Tarn swallowed the food down his throat.
Do you think he signed up for the cadet too?
Perhaps he was a tourist, assuming by how lavish his outfit was.
Sure thing. Can you see what's on that dude's table? There is an applicant dossier on it with the Air Force emblem.
Tarn started to think that Yai was prying on the other so loud that the nearby crowd veered their attention to look at them. So the young man poked the big brother to resume his own meal and quit gossiping by now. To opt in or not opt in was absolutely that dude's business. Sure as hell he didn't look for trouble here, damn it.
Auntie, I'll have stir-fried pork with holy basil, please. No chili, no MSG, half teaspoon of sugar, and a tablespoon of vegetable oil. I'd better have a half teaspoon of each seasoning instead of, and no long bean too.
Holy cow, who the heck ordered that? Yai and Tarn exchanged their gaze, startingly, with the eyes searching for the order owner, curious to see that damn face. Why wouldn't he cook it himself for such a tricky order? Here it goes. Even the auntie beat her spatula with a pan. There, she pointed her utensil at that guy.
Kid, why don't you just do it yourself?
Even the cook thought the same thing. Yai swooped back and smiled at Tarn, who tried not to laugh and shared their nodded, knowing glance. That fella wouldn't be able to get his messy meal, but would instead get kicked out of the shop.
Auntie, I'm a clean eater, so I might be a little too much detailed on it. I can write it down for you.
That nerd told the female cook nervously. Yes, he didn't mean to annoy her.
What a nerd is a clean eater? I can't do that for you. If you want to eat like that, go find it on the mainland.
Well,
The sound of the moving chair creaked at Tarn's back. The tall figure in a black jacket walked past Tarn and Yai's table towards that glasses nerd and handed out a food box to him.
Whole food. I had bought it for myself, but I didn't eat it.
The sight of that man's face in the black leather jacket captivated Tarn. That prominent nose, distinct eyes, dark eyebrows, white and healthy skin, sculpted side profile with a well-defined chiseled jawline that reminded him of someone he had met before. But where?
Thank you.
That nerd took the food box and smirked at that man.
Don't mention it, but if you're here for the training but still a picky eater like this, it might cause you trouble.
What a pleasantly deep, low-pitched, soothing voice. Hey, and why the heck do I have to swoon over that dude's voice too?
Eh? Do you know that I'm here for the training too? Yeah, I saw your PCS order.
PCS order is permanent change of station order. Yai lifted his glass to gulp down the water with the ear hustling at the same time. The way he was as a kid stuck with him even as he grew up. A nosy Parker as always.
Oh yes, I signed up here to join the DSI unit.
Yai snorted water so hard that his face was red as a beetroot, tugging the tissue paper to wipe his mouth while Tarn, who had a hunch about it, moved his plate away just in the nick of time.
What the hell of you? I almost have to reorder my meal.
Snapped Tarn. That was so close, my dear meal.
Are you the one who's going to join the DSI unit? A nerd, dumb and space like yours will be able to handle it?
Said a narrow-eyed guy with his company, burst out laughing in sync. Tarn and Yai looked into each other's eyes displeasedly. How utterly potty-mouthed they were, looking down on other people like this. Watch it. They may be the ones who got kicked in the dirt. That man in the jacket looked over his shoulder to see those men, then reached to grip the nerd's shoulder.
I wish you the best in the training. Don't take those foul mouths to heart. Hey, Peacock, are you chewing me out? I didn't mention anyone specifically. Just say it in passing.
Ah, that's what you got, Trust Chalker. Just one strike back and you all frotted at the mouth.
The jacket guy didn't react, but just rotated on his heels and walked down the stairs. That was when Tarn could sense something fishy. He rose up and rushed to kick that squinty-eyed dude until he fell against his friends.
Did you just kick me?
Yeah, I can't help it because you were trying to sucker kick him first.
Kaya stopped his feet and looked back to the thud behind him and found an unblemished skinned man in a gray t-shirt and pale jeans standing with arms crossed, lowering his gaze to the guy whom Priya had recently argued with in a mocking manner.
I didn't do anything yet.
Do you dare swear that you didn't get up to kick him?
Priya's eyebrows tied a knot. He glared at the man with whom he had an argument and started to understand the situation. That man was trying to ambush him. Luckily, he was saved by this guy.
You! Do you dare?
Tarn enunciated his question word by word. That dude lost for words. He couldn't deny it, as what Tarn said was true.
A military man like you taking a cheap shot like this is totally unacceptable. Not to mention insulting this nerdy man. Do you really think this is what should be done? Is that right, Auntie?
That flawless-faced man turned to ask the female shop owner. The shop owner shifted her gaze with a lackluster expression.
Now what? If you want to fight, do it somewhere else. If you guys want to fight here, think again, because my hubby is your trainer.
Tarn's face turned drab in embarrassment. He loosened his crossed arms and stepped back from that dumb-faced dude a little further. It seemed that Auntie wasn't joking too.
Enough of it, Chart. Just finish your meal and pay, so we can report for duty,
said the curly-haired man. He put his money on the table and was the first to leave. The rest of the group gradually followed suit, except for that dude who still glared at him. However, he didn't approach them for another fight. He just slammed his money on the table and stomped away infuriatingly.
He must be very angry,
the nerdy guy said.
Let him be. A person like that is only good at ranting on the others.
Yai told the nerdy guy while patting him on the shoulder. Seeing the situation subsided, Paya approached to the man who saved him.
Thank you for saving me.
Tarn slowly turned back to the black jacket guy. Their eyes met, captivated. The familiarity between both of them was inexplicable. Tarn lowered his gaze to that man's neck and found a familiar braided rope on it. The past flashed back across his mind. Isn't this guy...
Is there anything on my face?
Oh my!
The nerdy guy's exclamation caused Tarn to instantly swallow his question down the throat. What's the point of that squeak? He turned around to look.
This whole food box is full of my favorite ingredients. Thank you so much.
That's all right.
Paya said to the nerdy guy and switched his gaze back to Tarn.
And thanks to you too. See you at the training ground.
Paya said, curled up a thin smile to Tarn and swiveled away. Tarn's gaze followed the tall figure's back with melancholic eyes. He began to be confident in his assumption that this man might be the boy he knew, yet he did not have the guts to ask.
You really have to drink the sight of him that much?
Yaya company turned to the side.
Let's get back to our meal.
Tarn had acted weird since a moment ago and thought that this big brother didn't notice, didn't he? He always getting sidetracked by hot guys, my poor boy. It's always this big brother's burden to snap him out of it. After their meal, Tarn and Yai brought the nerdy guy, whose later name became known as Singh, to report for duty altogether. The three carried their rucksack to the assembly point. After a short wait, the trainer blew the whistle to summon everybody. He rushed to line up, listening to the rules and the daily training routine in brief.
Alright, before we commence our training, I want each of you to change into your training attire. You have 5 minutes. After that, assemble back here. Time!
Hearing the order, everyone grabbed their belongings and ran to the barracks. Tarn and Yai had initially set their sight on the bed right by the door to save some time when running their personal errand. But when the two showed up, Chart and his mates had been changing clothes at the bed end earlier.
Sorry, Paz. You happen to be fast,
said Chart in a taunting voice. Tarn and Yai inhaled deeply to pacify the longing to kick someone in the butt and kept on searching for unoccupied beds. They eventually found vacancies tucked away in the corner at the end of the hallway, one to the left and the other to the right. Even though it meant that they had to sleep separately, there was no problem for them. The two brothers settled in and changed their attire in a swift action, then followed the other warriors to the training ground.
All right, the first training here is...
Today's first session was basic training, like a timed obstacle course, which Tarn could pass with no sweat due to his familiarity with his self-training in the forest. At the same time, Yai, who had a thick, bulky body, kept complaining throughout the session. For the nerdy guy, Tarn wheeled around to look for him. What a sloth. So he got kicked by the trainer to hurry him up. What about that man? Tarn swept his gaze and found that the other person was just right next to him. That man looked at him in return, raising his eyebrow questioningly. Tarn didn't say anything but just gave a thin smile and averted his gaze to the crowd. Well, he would seek an answer if this guy was Paya during the evening meal. Paya cast a doubtful gaze at the guy beside him. But after seeing Tarn playing dumb as if nothing had happened, he said nothing either. Nonetheless, Paya secretly observed the man by his side and noticed a yellowish light complexion, prominent nose, round eyes, petite mouth, and fairly sweet face. However, the man stood at the height of his ear, with a deceptively cherubic visage that Paya couldn't believe the man was 26 years old like him. And on top of everything, he was a cop, a fish out of water, just like Singh. Never imagined that once like them would be in this role.
Wait! Attention, soldiers. That's all for today's training. Get ready for tomorrow's grueling phase, both in theory and practice.
The trainer kept on his lengthy lecture for a few more moments and let them go to take a bath for 10 minutes, then reassemble for the evening meal right on time. Tarn followed the other troops to the barracks, picking up the personal items and taking them to the communal bathroom. When they arrived, Chart and the crew had already been there. Shit, why were they so fast?
Singh, do you want to join bathing with us?
Tarn swooped to ask Singh, who seemed hesitant to take a bath with others. What the heck? Hadn't he experienced such a situation before? Those eligible to get on the list for this session must have been commissioned officers. But look at him. Nothing like a cop or a grunt like us.
Yes, yes, I'd love to.
Singh responded and hurriedly accompanied them.
Oh, I'm sorry.
Don't you watch where you're going, nerd?
Tarn pivoted and found Chart and Singh were confronting, so he advanced the two. Damn it, they opened fire again. And who started it must have been Chart, the same old troublemaker.
Why do you have to mess things up, Chart? Singh has already said sorry.
Tarn interrupted while reaching them. Chart switched his glare to him before pushing him by the shoulder, until he staggered against someone in the back. Lucky for him, a person held him up. Otherwise, he would have hit the floor. Tarn lifted his gaze to a person who helped him and saw that guy, so he said thank you softly before startling a little and seeing the other's necklace. Borrowed necklace? Yai figured out the situation was likely to escalate, so he broke in on their argument to clear the hot air. As, according to seniority, he was the oldest one here among these 50 warriors.
Think twice before you start the fight, Chart. Here, they punish everyone. They don't care if you're involved. Do you want to throw your friends in hot water? Let me tell you, I'm cool with that. I'm more than ready.
Chart bulged his cheek with the tongue and glared at Tarn, Singh, and that posh guy before throwing the water bowl in the tank, barging into Singh's shoulder and leaving. So this is what they say, if you have to fight, don't fight with shirts. Tarn's eyes still locked on that man's face unwaveringly. Never thought that after 14 years, they would bump into each other again in such a situation. Never thought that people like Paya would become a cop, a soldier, or even join DSI.
You're good?
Paya asked and helped the slim figure in his arm to stand up properly because the bathroom floor was slippery. Tarn beamed and reached for Paya's amulet necklace, making Paya startle. Paya drew himself back and brushed Tarn's hand off right away.
What are you doing?
This necklace meant the world to Paya, despite having many amulet collectors who sought after it so much that they offered him 10 to thousands of grand, he still declined that deal. But this man recklessly reached out to touch it without bother asking. Absolutely no manners.
I'm taking a look at your necklace, silly question.
How could he still have the nerve to say taking a look at his necklace with that nonchalant face? What kind of man was he? We weren't that close to be laying hands on the other's personal belongings.
Back off.
Raya finished bathing, and the good citizen to save the world from the bullies had already been off duty. Tarn blocked him from leaving.
Stay and talk a little longer, won't you, Raya?
Then the man called out his name loud and clear, standing there and hearing everything. Yai widened his eyes a little bigger, looking at the posh guy he had gossiped about a few hours ago in surprise. Don't tell me that this guy did that kid back then. Kaya furrowed his brows. He couldn't remember telling the man his name, so how did he know that? Yai walked up to both of them and said,
"You, are you the kid who drowned in the Mekong River when you were young?"
Kaya gave Yai a disapproved look. How did these people know his past? And when he switched his gaze back to meet those round, sparkling eyes of the man in front of him, who was smirking contentedly, Kaya could sense something uncanny even more.
How did you guys know that?
Tarn didn't answer that question. Instead, he stretched his hand out toward Kaya.
My name is Tarn. Nice to officially meet you.
Kaya intensely tightened his brows, cast his gaze downward at that gesture, and let out a sigh before softly shaking that offering hand and drawing himself back.
Is that all?
Then he could finally leave. Moreover, he didn't want to socialize with these people for too long due to the displeasure that these people were privy to his past. The more they mentioned it, the more that image of that figure popped up in his head and left him all shaking.
What do you mean, is that all? Did you just forget about us?
Yai asked before introducing himself.
My name is Yai, Tarn's friend.
My name is Singh.
Singh wanted to join the party too. Yai sighed.
Doesn't everyone know that, nerd?
With such a posture, everyone questioned how he managed to qualify to be here.
So, you can't remember me?
Kaya knitted his eyebrows even tighter. Did he ever get to know him? Even though his face rang a bell, he really didn't know this guy.
Why do you keep beating around the bush, asking if he can remember you? Why don't you just tell him you're his rescuer from the Mekong?
His rescuer from the Mekong?
He can swim, can't you? Why didn't you swim back to the shore? Rarod necklace, I'll give it to you.
Kaya looked at Tarn astoundingly. The picture of their first encounter flashbacked, overlapping the slim, tall man right before him. The sweet-smiled boy back then grew up to be this man right now.
You?
It's me!
Tarn said lightheartedly, while mischievously raising his eyebrow once. Kaya smiled in delight and astoundingly laid his eyes on the man he hadn't met for 14 years, thanks to the Prarad necklace that Tarn gave him. Otherwise, they couldn't recognize each other. He beamed from ear to ear in elation to run into his lifesaver again and even become the competitor in joining the DSI team.
Hey, time's up for a small trading affair. Go take a bath now so we can go to the canteen.
Yai interrupted both of them, who kept ogling each other like forever. Have you guys no shame? 8:30 p.m. Tarn had too many questions to ask Paya, as well as Paya had too many questions waiting for Tarn to answer. After their evening meal, the two kept chatting all the way back to the barracks. Even after getting into the bedroom, they were still talking as if they had been bonded for their entire life, despite the fact that they met only once 14 years ago.
Where's your bed?
There.
Hey! Do we sleep next to each other?
Don't you know that?
By the time Tarn chose the bed, Kaya had been changing next to him. Tarn put on a derpy face.
A guy like him never notices anything, said Yai.
How his brother was top-notch in his supernatural sense, but it came bundled with a whole lot of superficiality.
P.I., get lost in your own bed, will you?
Chase Tarn, don't you throw shade at me. P.I. wrung his mouth. He knew how much his little brother wanted to talk to Paya, so he set himself aside on his own bed. Paya and Tarn reached their own bed and talked to each other in a low voice.
He said you have something to ask me. What is it?
Tarn was eager to know as Paya didn't spill his guts when Yai was with them. Paya cast a thoughtful face in reluctance if he should ask it out. It was long ago and Tarn might have already forgotten, but he didn't. That thing had turned into a nightmare that kept haunting him every single night. Tarn shifted his body to Paya's bed.
If you're afraid that the others would hear, you can whisper it to my ear,
said Tarn, turning his ear toward Paya. Paya looked at Tarn's posture and smirked while hitting that shoulder once. No sooner had he said anything than a sound came from all the cadets to go to sleep, so Tarn was back to his own bed and collapsed himself onto the mattress in a swift manner, as well as Paya. Both of them turned sideward to one another. The light bulb from the outside lit up both faces.
When you rescued me in the Mekong River,
Tarn was all ears to every word Paya was going to say.
Did you see anything?
Tarn furrowed his brows.
See anything?
When he plunged into the river, all he could see back then were the water plants. That was all he could remember. Paya startled. Right. If Tarn had seen anything, was it possible that a guy like him wouldn't talk about it? Since Tarn didn't say anything at the time, supposedly, Tarn didn't see it. Indeed. Paya swallowed the saliva down his throat and faced up the ceiling instead. He might have hoped far too much, hoped that anyone would see it like he did, that he wasn't the only one out of his mind. Seeing Paya fall into silence, the sight of that puzzling face worried Tarn. To ask a question like that could imply that he must have seen something underwater. Wang Por said that Mekong is a sacred river with many mythical stories. Tarn didn't believe it because he didn't witness it with his own eyes. Only Luang Por, who was apparently very anxious when Tarn was near Mekong. Consequently, Luang Por insisted he must not say anything about what he saw in Mekong. Otherwise, he would be swallowed down by the sacred river. Even though he didn't believe it, he always did what he was told strictly. Even if one does not believe it, one must not profane it. Looking at Paya, who fell in silence for so long, Tarn called out his name.
Paya.
Nothing. It might have been just an illusion.
Illusion, my ass. The illusion that stuck in his head until the present.
I believe that you may have seen something under the water.
Paya cast a glance at Tarn and beheld those bright, round eyes with an unwavering gaze. Just a word from Tarn believing him, he didn't know why his heart had to swell by delight this much. Tarn smiled and continued.
This world still holds a lot of things we don't know. Anything is possible because nothing is certain. If he did see something under the water, I think that stuff might have been true. But they just couldn't see it but you. And even though no one else could see it like he did, it doesn't mean it isn't true.
Just like his ability to see the signs, his clairvoyance, his sixth sense.
Thank you.
Oddly enough, every time he met or was with Tarn, Paya always felt safe and sound to have Tarn around, just like this time. Tarn comforted him so much to the point where he felt astonished. Even though they had met only a few times before, it felt like the two were old acquaintances.
Go to sleep. See three, mate.
Tarn couldn't handle it any longer. Both eyes were forced to shut. Paya nodded to Tarn and resumed his gaze back to the ceiling. He pondered over his dreams throughout these 14 years. Every single picture of it was still vivid in his mind. Priya assumed it might have been that creature, the one that people worshipped. But why did it keep replaying, extorting something from him in his sleep for all these 14 years? Did he take anything from it? As Priya kept diving into his own thoughts for a moment, soon enough, he sank into the darkness. Priya felt as if he suffocated. He opened his eyes and swept his gaze around. Again, he was here again, underneath this Mekong River, with the same old monster. Priya widened his eyes as he looked at that enormous figure advancing towards him. He was striving for his life to emerge himself from the water, but he could not. That red-eyed figure stared at him full of loathing, as if it came after him to take his life.
My precious! I shall reclaim it!
What is that, precious? Priya shook his head. No, he didn't have it.
I shall reclaim it!
Priya wide opened his eyes. It rapidly swarmed towards him. He tried hard to escape, but couldn't move. No.
Priya!
Priya's eyes flew open wide as he sprang up and sat on the bed. He swept his gaze around and saw everyone else was hurriedly folding their blanket and picking their own water bowl and left. So he did it as well before turning to Tarn, who was waiting for him at the bed end and looking at him with worry.
Let's go.
Tarn nodded in approval. The two rushed out to catch up with the other fellows. Priya clenched his jaw tightly. That dream again. When will this crazy dream ever let him be? End of chapter 2.